Congressman.
No, you guys are pretty good this year. You guys, I'm worried. I think you guys are probably, you're going to come in favored in the Camp Randall, is my guess.
It's going to be fun to watch both of our running backs.
Absolutely.
On that Saturday. Well, Congressman, I had a chance to hang out with Governor Mitt Romney this past Monday night. What do you think of that man? It's been a few years since you traversed the country together, and he was in town stumping for Ben Sasse, who's looking to be our next U.S. Senator. I just really found Governor Romney to be a very engaging and a personable guy. Do you guys still keep in touch at all?
We do. We keep in touch frequently. We've become very close friends. I adore the man. I mean, I think the country sees this now. He would have made a fantastic president. He's got the vision, the principles, the integrity, and the experience to make a great leader and to be a good president, a great president. And, you know, we see what the Obama administration looks like in practice, you know, big government in practice these days versus the theory and promise of big government that, you know, he ran on in 2012 and 2008. And unfortunately, you know, it's a bit of a buyer's remorse for many of us in the country. And right now we've got a chance to roll back the Obama agenda. That's why, you know, I'm asking folks, please get out and vote for Lee Terry. You know, we need to have more leaders in the House like Lee and take the Senate with people like Ben. I've known Ben for a number of years. He's a great leader, a really good policymaker.
Yeah.
You know, so we've got a chance to put a check on the Obama agenda, to advance things like Keystone Pipeline, which I know is big in Nebraska, and make a difference in this election.
But you and Congressman Terry have served in Congress since, if I'm not mistaken, the same time.
We call it classmates. Lee and I are classmates.
That's right. Some people have said around here, of course, a lot of these people have no intention of voting for Congressman Lee Terry, that he's been there at Capitol Hill for about 16 years, and he's failed to make a name for himself, and he hasn't done anything. You've been there every day with him. What has Congressman Lee Terry done?
Look, there are differences between show horses and workhorses. There are people who do or don't seek the limelight, and there are folks who do their job, put their nose down, and hit the grindstone. That's the kind of Congressman Lee Terry is. And so Lee's not out there trying to get attention in the cameras. He's an important subcommittee chairman in the Commerce Committee, one of the most important committees in Congress. He's authored a number of bills just this last year that have passed the House. The problem we got is the Senate won't do anything. And so Lee is one of those workhorses in Congress, doesn't seek the limelight, but does his work, and he's advanced a lot of things. He's our point guy on Keystone Pipeline. That issue is going to come front and center in just a couple of months if we get the Senate. We're going to do it again in the House no matter what, but if we get the Senate. And so Lee Terry is poised to be in a very good position to make a huge difference. Contrast that with his opponent, Ashford, I believe is his name.
Yes.
Who's just another reliable rubber stamp for Nancy Pelosi and Barack Obama. I mean, why on earth would we want to send somebody from Nebraska, of all places, to be a Pelosi vote and an Obama supporter when we have a chance of making a big difference, having a stronger House majority? Lee is a senior person in the House who is running a very important subcommittee that's going to make a big difference on jobs, on the economy, on things like Keystone and energy, and our vast majority of our energy policies come from Lee's committee. And so he is a person who's going to be in the driver's seat of unleashing America's energy. And then if we get the Senate with guys like Ben Sasse over there, you know, we're going to really be able to put things on President Obama's desk, and Lee is going to be at the table writing that legislation. So that's very important.
I got a few things to ask you about the potential of Republicans taking back the Senate and, of course, maintaining control of the House. You have been, Congressman, my answer to several people calling the show over the last 3 or 4 years saying, well, Republicans don't have any ideas. They don't propose anything. They're just the party of no. And I always say, have you paid any attention to what Congressman Paul Ryan has been proposing? Budget, Medicare issue fixes and things of this nature. You constantly have ideas. And as you mentioned, they go nowhere in the Senate. What are you looking to do if Republicans take over the Senate? What can the House and Senate do together?
We can make President Obama make a decision or two. Here's what's going on. They have this sort of a good cop, bad cop routine with Harry Reid. Harry Reid stops every bill we pass. Look, I've authored and passed 4 balanced budgets that balance the budget and pay off the debt. You know, I'm pushing a lot of welfare to work programs to get people from welfare back into the workforce. You know, we've got all these issues on job creation, energy policy, Keystone, which is one of Lee's big issues. And take a look at what happens. Harry Reid just kills him. I mean, he won't even let him come up for a vote. Then president basically says, the Congress isn't doing anything, so I'm going it alone. I'm doing it myself. I've got a phone and a pen, and I'm going to do executive orders. And so Reid prohibits the president from having to make a decision. The president then says Congress is dysfunctional because Harry Reid's made it dysfunctional, and he uses that as an excuse to go it alone and go around the Constitution. We want to remove that excuse. We get the Senate. We put these bills on President Obama's desk and make him make a decision or two. And I believe if we can do that, we also get the power of the purse. We're really worried about some of these regulations coming out of the White House, whether it's something that he might do that's unconstitutional on immigration, or whether it's, you know, the EPA trying to regulate farm runoff water. It's just crazy. Mm-hmm. And we can put riders on appropriation bills to stop this executive overreach if we get the House and the Senate.
If you want to hear more about, I'm talking now to KFAB Nation here, if you want to hear more about the EPA trying to regulate farm water runoff and that issue, you have to listen on the Scott Voorhees page at KFAB.com to my conversation with Senator Chuck Grassley last week. He went into great detail. He was all fired up about it for Iowa. Let me ask you this question as we talk with Congressman Paul Ryan from Wisconsin here. From a Democrats advocate standpoint, they'll say, all right, Congressman, you and Lee Terry have both been in the House of Representatives long enough that you were there when Republicans did have the House and the Senate and the executive office as well. And we didn't have meaningful health care reform. We didn't have Medicaid and Medicare reform. We didn't have a clear energy policy. We had this chance and the government grew and we didn't get these things. Why would this time be any different?
Well, I think take a look at our actions of recently. Take a look at the fact that we have passed balanced budgets. We have taken on entitlement reform. We have proposed tax reform. Look at the actions that we've had just in the last 3 or 4 years, the things we've passed out of the House that do tackle these things. Look, I just wrote a book, and I think you and I spoke about this. I do think our party lost its way in the early 2000s, and I think we lost our way on fiscal responsibility. I put my first budget out there, the roadmap, during the Bush administration because I thought fiscal policy was not where it needed to be. And I think Republicans went soft, especially with earmarks. Look, Lee Terry helped us ban the earmarks that were so corrupt, that were big government Republicanism. And so we needed to clean up our act. I would argue we have cleaned up our act. And since then, since the 2010 elections, we in the House have been passing bold conservative reforms that actually fix this country's problems. And I think it's important that we acknowledge that Republicans earlier have made some mistakes. Now, having said all of that, you know, we have passed, even in those days, a lot of things, but without 60 votes in the Senate, it's pretty hard to get really meaningful things through. But one more point. President Bush was focused on defeating terrorists. He was focused on keeping the country safe after 9/11, and we were in two simultaneous wars. So it did basically take his attention and place it in other areas, and that's understandable. But as Republicans, we've got to get back to being limited government, free enterprise, liberty advocates. And the House Republicans have been doing that. We've been doing it because you've seen the bills we've passed that actually embrace these principles and apply these principles. Now we have a Senate that is stuck, that does nothing. And so we need to win these elections, have a stronger House majority, put Nancy Pelosi deep in the minority so that we can pass these bold conservative reforms that we've already shown you what they look like. We've already voted on them in the House. And then get them moving through the Senate and put them on Obama's desk and give the country a very clear, bold choice.
We're still battling terrorism in this country. What do we do with ISIS, and what do you think of the administration's response to this threat?
Administration made critical mistakes in Syria and Iraq that helped give rise to this threat. Now I believe that the president is micromanaging the military, second-guessing the military. What you need to do is give the military the mission, and then what they say they need to do to complete the mission and let them finish it off. And I fear that the president is micromanaging them. The other problem is Obama wants to decimate our military. His budget says shrink the Army to a level we haven't seen since pre-World War II, shrink the Air Force to a level we've never seen before, and shrink the Navy to a level we haven't seen since pre-World War I. That, to me, is reckless. At a time when we have so many threats around the country, you should not be shrinking our military to a level most of us haven't seen in our lifetimes. You vote for Ashford, you're voting for that. You're voting for Nancy Pelosi. I mean, she's to the left of Obama.